How do we feel about lace? What kind of material?
I'm not completely opposed to lace, but I'm open to anything. Sure. I just want
simplicity and nothing like too fitted, but nothing too full.
Exactly. Okay.
Do you think you'll both wear dresses? Or?
Yeah, we want to both wear dresses.
Sure. It just depends. I mean, we've done a few.
Have you done other gay weddings?
Yes, we have. Yep. Yeah. But almost always one wears a tux. But it just kind of depends.
I know. We both want to wear dresses. Yeah. We think it'll be,
I think that's fun.
I like this one a lot. Oh, yeah, that one's really pretty. Let's check it out. What I would say to the tribes that do not recognize gay and lesbian marriages is think about your ancestors. Think about your past.
Marriage is a sacred thing.
Do anything because they won't listen to him anyway.
It was created by our God, you know? It was to be a man and woman.
Two-spirited people in our societies hundreds of years ago, they held a place. They had their place without shame.
I would rethink this whole legal marriage thing, because just because something's legal doesn't make it right.
It's like we're dehumanized. We are human beings. We are part of, you know, as a two-spirit person, we should be part of our culture. We should be part of our traditions. We should be part of our ceremonies. But we're not, and we need to change that.
Native Americans inhabited this continent for centuries. Almost 200 years ago, enormous cultural shifts occurred. The Indian Removal Act of 1830 required them to conform to European-American ways of life. Living on the reservation has been extremely difficult for Indian populations. Two-spirit people were forced to adapt to even more changes. The phrase two-spirit refers to Native Americans who identify as lesbian, gay, bisexual, or transgender. Generations ago, they were once revered and woven into the fabric of their tribes. Today, that's not the case. This documentary examines how and why cultural attitudes have dramatically shifted and the consequences of those changes on two-spirit people and their communities.
Only a few tribes have embraced the rainbow of social change currently sweeping the nation and the world.
For us, for Lakota people and Dakota people, we've recognized transgender, gay, lesbian people for centuries, for maybe millennia before Europeans arrived on our continent.
Chase Iron Eyes is a Native American civil rights activist.
If you think we're gonna let you come into our territory and threaten our children.
He protests against injustice and inequality throughout the Dakotas.
You've got another thing coming.
Now he's advocating for changes in tribal code concerning same-sex marriage.
It's definitely important for us to be able to grant marriage licenses in tribal courts, because tribal courts are one of the most important expressions of our sovereignty, of our ability to govern ourselves.
Iron Eyes was once a tribal judge for the Mandan Hidatsa Arikara Nation. Same-sex marriage is not a part of that tribe's code. In fact, many sovereign Native nations in America have different laws regulating marriage licenses.
I have a partner, and I've been with my partner for 5 years. We would be recognized outside of the tribe, but we wouldn't be recognized within the tribe if we had chose to get married.
Lenny Hayes is a two-spirit activist.
Hi, can I get a large coffee?
He travels the country educating people on issues that face Native LGBT people.
Thank you.
He had mixed emotions when the Supreme Court ruled on same-sex marriage.
When that first passed way back in June, I was really excited about that because I do have a lot of friends who identify as LGBTQ. But I was also saddened because it doesn't affect our tribes, because we are our own sovereign nation.
Hayes says two-spirit people face an uphill battle changing community attitudes and tribal laws of their nations. Lexi Luger and Rane Antel are also caught in the middle of this contentious conflict.
Oh, boy.
Oh, yeah.
I like this waistline.
I finally have met my soulmate, because not only did I meet another woman, but we're both Native.
This back is really pretty.
Weddings are a huge deal on the reservation. You know, a lot of people get married and a lot of people go through everything and have the big dress, and
I didn't see myself doing this, you know, being in a white dress and stuff, but
before I could never, I think, have imagined spending my life with Rene.
Yep.
But now that I do, it just seems so natural and so, I feel so comfortable standing next to her.
There are 562 recognized tribes in the United States. 26 of them allow same-sex marriage, meaning in their tribal code, there's language that specifies the act of marriage can be between a man and a woman, two women, or two men. 11 tribes have language specifically prohibiting two people of the same gender from getting married. Now here's where it gets complicated. The rest of them don't have any guidelines. That means who can get married could be up to the interpretation of the judges of that tribal nation. Or it could be that the responsibility for granting marriage licenses is abdicated to the county registrar. Many tribes are trying to clarify who can and can't get married. The issue isn't clear in the Mandan Hidatsa Arikara Nation. Mark Fox is the chairman of the three affiliated tribes. He was elected to bring change and transparency to the government of his reservation.
We want to hear it.
He wants to allow the 15,000 members of his tribe to express their opinions through referendums. Same-sex marriage is one of the reforms he supports putting on a ballot.
Have a vote and say, do you support having the possibility of same-sex marriage on the reservation? And I'll let them choose, our people. If that's what they want to do, we'll implement it. If they don't, then we'll keep it as is.
If a vote is held, it's unclear what the outcome would be.
Change is hard, but I don't know. I don't know what I would do.
I guess I'd have to vote no, because I'm Catholic. And that's just the way I've been taught.
I don't think people would be too accepting of it around here.
Before allowing all the members to have a say on this issue, first, the tribal council members must vote to approve having same-sex marriage as a yes or no option on the ballot.
I'd probably vote for it. You know, I think people should be able to do what they want to do.
My best friend and my sister also have same-sex relationships, and it's all about who you love and about how you feel, and it shouldn't matter if it's a man or a woman, same-sex, and if you love that person, you should be allowed to get married anywhere.
Chairman Fox intends to bring this referendum to the council for a vote.
Let's head 150 miles south now to Fort Yates. The small town sits in the center of the Standing Rock Reservation, where this issue is also not addressed in the tribal code. The way it handles marriages is to have the county issue licenses to straight or gay couples.
Lexi Luger and Rane Antel are a minority within a minority.
Her grandma's like, "My girl, you don't even look like a lesbian. You don't look like Rane's ex." I like that, though, when people tell me I don't look like a lesbian. I'm like, I didn't know we were supposed to look a certain way.
They've been in a committed relationship since 2012.
After meeting Rene, I felt this huge relief.
Lexi is funny, outgoing. She's, she always makes me laugh all the time. She always has something to say that's hilarious. She's always dancing around the house or making a joke. She's a very bubbly person, very happy all the time.
Rane is my balance, where I am goofier, I think a little crazier. She always kind of grounds me.
This past summer in the mountains of Colorado,
it was just like the most perfect moment.
They made it official.
I got down on one knee in the snow and I proposed to her and she said yes.
The couple plans on getting married on the Standing Rock Reservation with a Sioux County marriage license. Lexi and Rane say it's extremely important for them to be married on tribal land because they feel so connected to their culture and their home.
The second you see the sign that says now entering Standing Rock Reservation, it's just like, I know when I would be gone for a long time and I would see that sign, I would just feel this immediate
relief off of my shoulders.
Selfridge is 20 miles west of Fort Yates. Nettie Ireland and TJ Brave Crow are also members of Standing Rock. They were prepared to go out of state to have their vows recognized.
Here, baby, here's some coffee.
Thank you.
We had plans of taking off to the state that would get us married, and then all of a sudden, I wake up one day and they say the gay marriage law passed, and I was like, ooh, and so the minute she came home, then we went and got married.
Even though the wedding ceremony was held without much planning, they say the license they received validates their love. Lexi hopes the same rights are someday extended to all couples on all reservations.
Think about how broken and disillusioned our communities are today, and how allowing your LGBT community to marry is only going to bring strength to your community.
How did tribal attitudes on this issue evolve? Some say the federal government's colonization efforts and the introduction of Christianity played key roles. Others dispute that theory. What's indisputable is that lesbian, gay, bisexual, and transgender people were once accepted within tribes. Today, that's not the case on most reservations. In fact, they had a term to identify those who defy gender norms, Wink Day.
Where did this term come about, Two-Spirit? Anyone have a thought on that?
Dakota Goodhouse is a Native American studies instructor at United Tribes Technical College. He says Wink Days are identified as having the spirit of both a male and a female.
When we use this word Wink Day, it has more to do with gender norms than sexual identity.
Goodhouse says defining people with sexual orientation is a recent trend of modern society.
Today, Two-Spirit, though, has a different connotation. And I think the American culture really stresses a sexual identification. And so whereas someone who was a Wink Day, they might be a man who doesn't conform to male gender masculinity roles. It had nothing to do with his personal sexual preferences either. A woman too, she might sang at a drum or had a drum or touched a drum or played a flute. While she defied sexual convention, she was called a Wink Day. That had nothing to do with her own personal sexual preferences.
Gaylene Yellowfat knew a Wink Day 60 years ago.
That time I was so young, I didn't know what Wink Day was, except that he was noted for his beadwork. So my mother would go there and she'd have him bead things for her. He lived in a house by himself, and I never ever saw him with another person of his own gender.
The term Two-Spirit became popular in the 1980s as a more modern way to identify LGBT Native people. Traditionally, Wink Day or Two-Spirit people held many roles within the tribal community. They specialized in beadwork and quilting, and they held designated roles in tribal ceremonies.
They were relied upon for things like naming children. It was something of great value, of great fortune to have your child named by a Wink Day person.
It's said they could also foretell the future. In fact, a Wink Day played a vital role in the Battle of 100 Slain. The battle took place on December 21st, 1866. Colonel William Fetterman and his troops were ambushed and routed by Lakota, Cheyenne, and Arapaho Indians. All 81 soldiers under Fetterman's command were killed.
The Oglala selected a Wink Day and put him up on the hill. He came back with this vision of a great victory, but there'll be a lot of losses.
The victory was the beginning of the end for the Plains Indians' nomadic way of life. Native Americans began surrendering to the U.S. Army and were dispatched to reservations. There, they were indoctrinated into a lifestyle they had never known.
Colonization affected American Indian people in several ways. A radical change of lifestyle, including going from a hunter-gathering people to become sedentary people. Change of identity, that affected our very names too. People were given new Christian American names. Their traditional name was often made their last name, and they were given a good Christian first name. Another drastic change was religious practices, religious beliefs, introduction of Christianity. Many American Indians were forced into Christianity.
The General Allotment Act of 1877 divided tribal land into private parcels for individuals to own and farm. By doing so, the gender norms among the tribes became more rigid. Males were then named the heads of households, and women were denied access to farming responsibilities and leadership within the community. Many advocates for Native LGBT rights say the introduction of Christianity also radically changed tribal attitudes.
We had to blend in to the church and do the Bible, and those things really weren't our way. You know, we had our own religion, we had our own way of doing things. And so I think over the years, being around people that have that attitude that it's not okay to be gay, it's against God's rule. But for Dakota people, we accepted everybody just openly.
Gaylean Yellowfat disagrees.
I don't really agree that it was Christianity, because my great-grandparents were here when this was founded, this mission. I think it's not Christianity, I think it's outside forces.
The outside force she's referring to is the federal government. Yellowfat is the acting principal of the St. Bernard Mission School on the Standing Rock Reservation. It was founded by Benedictine nuns who opposed government regulations forced on Native American students at the public reservation school.
They took away a lot of the language, they took away a lot of the ceremonies.
Yellowfat says students were also forced to cut their hair and were given Christian names. None of those rules were followed at the Catholic Mission School.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Father Basil Atwell is the pastor of the Catholic Indian Mission. Atwell says the goal of missionaries who founded the school in 1910 was to spread the teachings of Jesus Christ, not to be oppressive.
The Catholic Church, wherever it goes, it doesn't remove the culture. I mean, go to a mass in Kenya, go to a mass in Nigeria, you're going to have dancing and everything else that they know how to celebrate. That's their culture. The church never removes that.
He says the Catholic Church's definition of marriage has never changed and never will.
God is creator, and we become, as human creatures, procreators. So you can see how God is in this mix when he gives you half the chromosomes and your wife has half the chromosomes to create this beautiful new life. That doesn't happen when two men come together or two women come together.
Although the Catholic Church does not condone homosexual activity, Atwell says it would never turn anyone away from the faith.
If the church didn't welcome them, the church would have to close its doors because we're all sinners.
Something people on both sides of the issue can agree on is two-spirit people face prejudice on and off the reservation.
Raise your hand if you know the difference.
There's a big difference in the way LGBT people are treated today.
As kids, when we said Wink Day, it wasn't like a derogatory thing, a name or anything. It was just who that person was, you know, and what he did. I've never heard them being disrespected like they are today.
The past 60 years, attitudes have evolved in society as a whole.
I've heard it with teenagers. Oh, that's gay of you, or, you know, something like that. And it's kind of a form of disrespect.
I grew up in a reservation and experienced a lot of being bullied, not accepted. I was even kicked out of high school because my cousin was the first case of HIV back in the 80s. And so I wasn't able to get my high school diploma with the tribal school.
Nettie Ireland says growing up, she too was bullied.
When I was younger, when people found out that I was gay, they would say mean words.
And what were some of the words that were the most hurtful to you?
Oh, you gay bitch, and stuff like that. And don't come around me, you might touch me. I just had to learn how to live with it and not let it get to me.
Sometimes the discrimination turns inward. Internalized homophobia refers to negative feelings towards one's sexuality. Many people who experience this feel the need to hide any gay tendencies and conform to social norms.
I definitely went through a lot of self-loathing myself. I went through a long, long, long period. Ronnie came out when she was in seventh grade. I didn't come out until I was in my 20s.
And I just decided to tell my mom, and it was like a year-long like battle. Like, we didn't get along for a while, but they love me no matter what, and now they couldn't see me any other way.
Bullying can have deadly consequences for two-spirit people.
There is a lot of violence that occurs on the reservations. I had, two very dear friends that were murdered from my own tribe, along with another individual that was murdered due to violence.
Suicide is a far more common cause of death for LGBT Native Americans.
And he will raise you up on eagle's wings.
A trail of tears and sorrow blankets many tribes. The anguish of suicide is too common, especially for Two-Spirit youth.
She was my everything. She was my other half. I miss her so much.
15-year-old Ayana Adrian England died on November 3rd, 2015. More than half of Two-Spirit transgender people have attempted suicide.
Knowing that she's gone now, it's hard, and I know I couldn't change it just by the way it was hurting her so much.
The community gathered to grieve in the Sisseton High School gymnasium, a place where the sophomore experienced joy and pain.
The reason she was so special is because she could turn everyone happy in an instant. And I've never met anyone that can actually do that, to make someone so happy with just one simple word.
Ayana Adrian loved Harry Potter movies, music, the rain, writing,
hola,
and making videos.
I love you.
Ayana Adrian's mother, Corey, said rather than talking around the house, the energetic kid would sing. Ayana Adrian's father, Weston, would change the lyrics of songs to add his own verses. Moments like that created a special bond between them.
She was amazing. Like, every morning, she made me smile with her laugh and just seeing her face and her jokes. She was so crazy. She was my light. She was my everything.
Ayana Adrian was a typical teen in almost every way.
Most people didn't understand her, didn't understand where she was coming from or how she felt. And I guess they just didn't take the time to understand her.
Ayana Adrian was Two-Spirit and gender fluid. Although close family and friends used she, her, and hers pronouns when referring to this teen, Ayana Adrian preferred they, their, and them pronouns as a reference.
I would see how she was dressed. I would feel her energy and how she was, and I'd be like, are you Ayana today, or are we Adrian?
That dual identity is the historical definition of a Winkday person, but it also created many misunderstandings that made life difficult.
She wanted to live her life as Adrian, her male spirit. She would go to school dressed like a boy. People would look at her and say, you're not a boy, you're a girl. So that would create conflict in itself, but she didn't care. She would just put her flannel shirt, and she'd wear a hat, and she would just embrace that. She would just go for it and just go into school, and she'd have to fight, you know, people who weren't comfortable with that.
In school and outside the classroom, Ayana Adrian stood up for a hoda, the Lakota word for respect.
We did a walk of respect, and at that walk, she opened up and she shared to the community about how she felt, how people would treat her, how people would talk about her, and how they perceived her.
And she stood in front of probably 100 youth who were sitting in a circle, and she told them, love one another for who you are. Be respectful. Bullying hurts anybody.
She just wanted to be loved. She just wanted to be accepted.
The last word she put on her Facebook page was, please don't hate me. That was her last message. Please don't hate me. That was the hard part. She was leaving, but yet she didn't want us to feel any more hate.
Suicide rates for Native Americans are more than double the national average. The Pine Ridge Reservation in South Dakota has the highest rate of suicide in the Western Hemisphere.
The LGBT community in general for under 25 years old is 5 times more likely to complete suicide than their straight peers. With that being said, inside the Native American community, that's even higher.
Raina Parker is the youth director of the Center for Equality in Sioux Falls, South Dakota. She says in addition to the struggles that LGBT people face, Native Americans on reservations are also disproportionately impacted by a number of other issues.
The poverty is very high. The joblessness is very high. Mental illness, substance abuse are also very high. And when the generation raising you also struggles, you inherit their burdens as well.
They say when a young person leaves us, there's always a lesson.
After the burial, Ayanna Adrian's parents, Corey Owen and Weston Quinn, presented quilts to some of the people who were closest to their child.
Alice has always been a good friend of Ayanna.
She's watching over us now. It just hurts because I wish more people understood her more. Maybe she still would have been here. Her message is going to get out there, and I'm going to make sure by the time I'm gone, I'm gonna make sure that everyone's equal. Just for her. That's my dream, and that was her dream, to be treated equally.
Over the last 150 years, Native culture has undergone immense changes, evolving from a hunter-gatherer society to reservation life. Now, seven generations later, some say even bigger changes are on the horizon.
Sitting Bull was a chief of the Lakota people. He prophesied in seven generations from him that seventh generation would revolutionize Native people. And Rane and I are part of that seventh generation. It's becoming proud of who you are, saying, yes, I am a Native American. I'm going to go out into the world and make a difference. I'm a person who comes from strength, who comes from a long line of people who overcame adversity, who were fighters, that you can say, wow, I want to be a part of that.